A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. Random House Audio presents Star Wars, The Old Republic, Deceived, by Paul S. Kemp. Read for you by Marc Thompson. Day 1, Chapter 1. Fat Man shivered, her metal groaning, as Zerid pushed her through Ord Mantell's atmosphere. Friction turned the air to fire, and Zerid watched the orange glow of the flames through the transparisteel of the freighter's cockpit. He was gripping the stick too tightly, he realized, and relaxed. He hated atmosphere entries. Always had. The long 40 count when heat, speed, and ionized particles caused a temporary sensor blackout. He never knew what kind of sky he'd encounter when he came out of the dark. Back when he'd carted Havoc Squadron commandos in a Republic gully jumper, he and his fellow pilots had likened the blackout to diving blind off a seaside cliff. You always hope to hit deep water, they'd say. But sooner or later, the tide goes out and you go hard into rock. Or hard into a blistering crossfire. Didn't matter, really. The effect would be the same.
Coming out of the dark, he said, as the flame diminished and the sky opened below.
No one acknowledged the words. He flew Fat Man alone. Worked alone. The only things he carted anymore were weapons for the exchange. He had his reasons, but he tried hard not to think too hard about what he was doing. He leveled the ship off, straightened, and ran a quick sweep of the surrounding sky. The sensors picked up nothing.
Deep water and it feels fine, he said, smiling.
On most planets, the moment he cleared the atmosphere, he'd have been busy dodging interdiction by the planetary government. But not on Ord Mantell. The planet was a hive of crime syndicates, mercenaries, bounty hunters, smugglers, weapons dealers, and spice runners. And those were just the people who ran the place. Factional wars and assassinations occupied their attention, not governance, and certainly not law enforcement. The upper and lower latitudes of the planet in particular were sparsely settled and almost never patrolled, a literal no-beings land. Zerid would have been surprised if the government had servsats running orbits over the area. And all that suited him fine. Fat Man broke through a thick pink blanket of clouds, and the brown, blue, and white of Ord Mantell's northern hemisphere filled out Zerid's field of vision. Snow and ice peppered the canopy, frozen shrapnel beating a steady rhythm on Fat Man's hull. The setting sun suffused a large swath of the world with orange and red. The northern sea roiled below him, choppy and dark, the irregular white circles of breaking surf denoting the thousands of uncharted islands that poke through the water's surface. To the west, far in the distance, he could make out the hazy edge of a continent and the thin spine of snow-capped, cloud-topped mountains that ran along its north-south axis. Motion drew his eye. A flock of leatherwings, too small to cause a sensor blip, flew 200 meters to starboard and well below him, the tents of their huge, membranous wings flapping slowly in the freezing wind, the arc of the flock like a parenthesis. They were heading south for warmer air, and paid him no heed as he flew over and past them, their dull black eyes blinking against the snow and ice. He pulled back on the ion engines and slowed still further. A yawn forced itself past his teeth. He sat up straight and tried to blink away the fatigue, but it was as stubborn as an angry bantha. He'd given the ship to the autopilot and dozed during the hyperspace run from Volta, but that was all the rack he'd had in the last two standard days. It was catching up to him. He scratched at the stubble of his beard, rubbed the back of his neck, and plugged the drop coordinates into the Navicomp. The comp linked with one of Ord Mantell's unsecured geosyncsats and fed back the location and course to Fat Man. Zerid's HUD displayed it on the cockpit canopy. He eyed the location and put his finger on the destination.
Some island no one has ever heard of, Up here where no one ever goes. Sounds about right.
Zerid turned the ship over to the autopilot and it banked him toward the island. His mind wandered as Fat Man cut through the sky. The steady pattern of ice and snow on the canopy sang him a lullaby. His thoughts drifted back through the clouds to the past, to the days before the accident, before he'd left the Marines. Back then, he'd worn the uniform proudly and had still been able to look himself in the mirror. He caught himself, caught the burgeoning self-pity, and stopped the thoughts cold. He knew where it would lead.
Stow that soldier, he said to himself.
He was what he was, and things were what they were.
Focus on the work, Z-Man.
He checked his location against the coordinates in the Navicomp. Almost there.
Gear up and get frosty, he said,
echoing the words he used to say to his commandos.
90 seconds to the LZ.
He continued his ritual, checking the charge on his blasters, tightening the straps on his composite armor vest, getting his mind right. Ahead, he saw the island where he would make the drop. 10 square clicks of volcanic rock, fringed with a bad haircut of waist-high scrub whipping in the wind. The place would probably be underwater and gone next year. He angled lower, flew a wide circle, unable to see much detail due to the snow. He ran a scanner sweep, as always, and the chirp of his instrumentation surprised him. A ship was already on the island. He checked his wrist chrono and saw that he was a full 20 standard minutes early. He'd made this run 3 times, and Arrigo, he was sure the man's real name was not Arrigo, had never before arrived early. He descended to a few 100 meters to get a better look. Arrigo's freighter, the doghouse, shaped not unlike the body of a legless beetle, sat in a clearing on the east side of the island. Its landing ramp was down and stuck out of its belly like a tongue. Halogens glared into the fading twilight and reflected off the falling snow, turning the flakes into glittering jewels. He saw 3 men lingering around the ramp, though he was too far away to notice any details other than their white winter parkas. They spotted Fat Man, and one waved a gloved hand. Zerid licked his lips and frowned. Something felt off. Flares went up from the freighter and burst in the air. Green, red, red, green. That was the correct sequence. He circled one more time, staring down through the swirl of snow, but saw nothing to cause alarm. No other ships on the island or in the surrounding sea. He pushed aside his concern and chalked his feelings up to the usual tension caused by dealing with miscreants and criminals. In any event, he could not afford to mess up a drop of several 100 million credits of hardware because he felt skittish. The ultimate buyer, whoever that was, would be unhappy, and the exchange would take the lost profits from Zerid in blood and broken bones, then tack it on to the debt he already owed them. He'd lost track of exactly how much that was, but knew it was at least 2 million credits on the note for Fat Man, plus almost half that again on advances for Era's medical treatment, though he'd kept Era's existence a secret, and his handler thought the latter were for gambling losses.
Elsie is secure.
He hoped saying it would make it so.
Going in.
The hum of the reverse thrusters and a swirl of blown snow presaged the thump of Fat Man's touching down on the rock. He landed less than 50 meters from Arrigo's ship. For a moment, he sat in the cockpit, perfectly still, staring at the falling snow, knowing there'd be another drop after this one, then another, and he'd still owe the exchange more than he'd ever be able to pay. He was on a treadmill, with no idea how to get off.
Didn't matter, though.
The point was to earn for Era. Maybe get her a hover chair instead of that wheeled antique. Better yet, prosthesis.
He blew out a breath, stood, and tried to find his calm as he threw on a winter parka and fingerless gloves. In the cargo hold, he had to pick his way through the maze of shipping containers. He avoided looking directly at the thick black lettering on their sides, though he knew it by heart. Had seen such crates many times in his military career.
Danger, munitions, for military use only. Keep away from intense heat or other energy sources. In the crates were upward of 300 million credits worth of crew-served laser cannons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.